people in the house, stand up. Let's praise him together. We're so glad you're here at Westview Community Church on this Easter Sunday. Our Savior lives, and we're going to shout it out.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called
again. We're so thankful that you're here worshiping with us. There's a lot on that worship guide that's going to tell you a little bit about Westview. The important part is we'd like to know a little about you. So there's a connect card. If this is your first time worshiping with us, would you take a second sometime in the service, fill it out. We've got a welcome center out there. We just want to thank you for choosing to be here with us on Easter Sunday. We also have a photo booth over here. It's a little dark for pictures right now, but after the service, if you want to grab your family, your friends, and grab a photo celebrating today, do that. We're going to continue in worship. Believer is all about, that the love of Christ, the salvation that we know, wouldn't be kept to ourselves, but that it would be shared to the ends of the earth, that those who don't know him would come to realize the precious gift that he has for them.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance.
Praise the Lord.
I lift you high in praise, my God. Oh, my King, I bless your name into eternity. I bless you every day and keep it up from now to eternity. God is magnificent. He can never be praised enough. There are no boundaries to his greatness. Generation after generation stands in awe of your work, and each one tells stories of your mighty acts.
Trophies at last I lay down.
Jesus, he came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives because he lives.
Good morning, everybody. Happy Easter. We are thrilled we get to start this Easter day off together. To our guests, we're glad you're here too. We're thrilled you are here. My name is Brian Smith. I'm our lead pastor. And when you walk through the door today, you got a worship guide that looks like this. In just a moment, you'll start seeing sermon notes pop up there, and they're right here on the back that you can follow along with us. I do have to make a point is that my voice is only half here. I have been battling a cold that just loves my voice box for like the last 4 days. So when I get excited, I'm going to squeak or lose all tone altogether. I haven't done this since I was 13. So, but I want to take us right away. I want to take us into the gospel story of the very first Easter morning. I want us to all dive into the pages of the Bible and this story. So let me make the setting here of what's going on. This is a very first Easter morning. It's around 30 AD. And there's two women that are in all four gospel accounts. Some gospel accounts describe a couple other women with these women, but the two women I want to focus on, are both of their names are Mary. There's Mary Magdalene, and the Bible describes another woman named Mary. And the reason why these two are important is because all four gospel accounts, they point to that these two witnessed Jesus on the cross. They saw him be crucified. But these two women also, it said, from a distance, saw where he was buried in a tomb on that Friday just before sundown. And so that first Easter morning starts with these two Marys. And these two Marys, man, the sun is just starting to come up that first Easter morning. And these two Marys' arms are full of spices. And they're starting to walk across town to head towards the tomb. And their job is not a pleasant one. Their job is to take these spices. Their job is to go into the tomb and unwrap Jesus' body and put more spices in there. And you wonder why? Well, they didn't use embalming in Jewish practice. And so this is kind of like spraying Febreze in the bathroom, if you kind of get my point. But they're taken there, and they're going to, the reason why this task is so hard is that while we assume that Jesus' body was cleaned up, they're going to witness as they unravel this his body in the tomb, they're going to witness all the bruises. They're going to witness all the wide open lacerations from the flogging that he endured. They're going to witness the holes in his wrists and his legs from the nails that pinned him to the cross. And so while their task is not a joyful one, they are devoted to him in love to go and do this for him. And so we start in the Gospel of Mark in chapter 16, verses 2 and 3. And in this early first Easter morning starts this way. It says, very early on Sunday morning, just at sunrise, Mary and Mary went to the tomb. On the way there, they were asking each other, who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb? They both know that the stone covering Jesus' tomb was going to be too heavy for them to move. But there's something else that these two Marys may have not known. As we go into the gospel story, after Jesus was buried, the Jewish leaders, who were doing everything they could to squash Jesus and his followers, they were successful in getting him to the cross. They went to Pilate, the governor, and said, "Hey, we remembered what Jesus said. He said in 3 days that he would rise again. So can you put guards on that tomb and seal that tomb?" And if these were Roman guards and they would have sealed that tomb, they would have put clay around it, put a rope around it with a Roman seal, and put guards on it. If you broke that seal, it was punishable by death. And I don't know if the Marys knew that as they're heading towards this tomb and are asking the question, who? They're just going. And as Marys head across town towards the tomb in their devotion, they are without hope. They have no hope. And they're anxious about this stone. So let's look at this first note together. God answered who? God answered who on the first Easter morning? God said, "Who is my son Jesus? And who is the angel who I have dispatched to share a life-changing message with everyone?" That's who. And we pick this up in the Gospel of Matthew. If you want to turn there in chapter 28, verses 1 through 6, we're going to hang on these six verses for a little while as we explore more of that first Easter morning. So Matthew 28, starting in verse 1, it says, early on Sunday morning, Matthew's projecting the same story. He says, "As the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake. For an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, and he sat on it. His face shone like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell into a dead faint. And then the angel spoke to the two Marys. He said, 'Don't be afraid.' He said, 'I know you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead, just as he said would happen. Come, see where his body was lying.' We look at Matthew. Here's those two Marys on their way with all these spices. And on their way, a violent earthquake shakes the land. Can you imagine what that's like on your way to a tomb? And it says, "For an angel dispatched by God," excuse me, "for an angel dispatched by God came down and rolled away the stone." The next phrase is very important. It says that the angel sat on a stone. Every word in the Bible is important. And this is the most unusual word, an unusual posture for an angel, to sit on a stone. Man, his face, it shined like lightning. His clothes were white as snow. You couldn't look at him. He was that bright. And it says the two guards that were there, they shook. The same word that they used for the two guards shook is the same word they used for earthquake. It was like, and then boom, they fell. Dead faint. Out. just laying there. And so I want to imagine a scene together. And you have to use your imagination. We got a tomb. Stones rolled right here. It's a tomb here and it's empty. There's an angel sitting on that stone. To his right are two women, Mary and Mary. They're trembling. They're scared. To his left, two guards, pasty, out cold. They're gone. Imagine this picture. This was the first Easter morning. Like, wow. This is how it started. So I want to speak from the perspective of the sitting angel. This angel, I don't know, there's a lot said about angels in the Bible. I don't know how they think or what their emotions are like, but this angel was called out of the millions, as it says, the millions of angels to deliver the most important message the world has ever heard. Good job. And you got to ask that one question is like, why an angel? I think this is important. I think only a divine being can disclose a divine truth that is beyond ordinary human experience and knowledge. What I'm saying here is that the resurrection, rising from the dead, is a concept mankind has never known before this morning. And to be able for our human minds to grasp something like this, it required a divine being sharing a divine truth. And so let's look at this next note together. You and I, we learn a lot from an angel sitting on a stone. First, we learn that we don't have to be afraid. We don't have to be fearful. He told Mary and Mary, he's sitting there. There's a reason why he's sitting. This is so important. He's sitting on his stone, and he's calm. He's unafraid. He's delivering this huge message. And the first thing I imagine his hands are doing to the two women to his right is this, saying, hey, it's okay. You don't have to be afraid. He's saying you don't have to be afraid now. But he's saying, you don't ever have to be afraid again with what I'm about ready to tell you. And that message is for us too in this room. That first Easter morning is why we celebrate Easter every day since. We don't have to be afraid. We don't have to be afraid now. And for those of us who believe in Christ Jesus, we don't have to ever be afraid, no matter what this world can throw at us. What else can we learn from an angel sitting on a stone? We can learn, let me go back to that be afraid. Why aren't we afraid? Let me answer that question. That's important. We don't have to be afraid because we have hope. What do we have hope in? That's the next note. Jesus isn't in the tomb. The angel, he's sitting here on his stone. He sees the Marys there with their arms full of spices for covering the stench of a decaying body. And he says, I know you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. You're looking for someone who's dead. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. He is alive. Amen. And I imagine the spices falling right out of their hands on the ground. To hear that, he's alive. This is important for us today. There are so many historical accounts. If there's anybody in here that doubts that the tomb was empty, do you know every historical account, not only in the Bible, but Roman history and everything else, points to Jesus really existed? Every religious tradition outside of Christianity said that he existed. Everybody agrees on the same thing. You can read biblical and extra-biblical evidence that the tomb was empty that day. Nobody disagrees with this. Jesus lived, and that tomb was empty. Now, everybody has their reasons they think why. But for us today, the Bible tells us through every gospel that tomb was empty. What else can we learn from an angel sitting on a stone? As he's sitting on that stone, the stone was rolled away not to let Jesus out. The stone was rolled away to let us in. That sitting angel, he sits for a reason. Those two women scared to death of what they're witnessing. And he's sitting there because he's approachable. And he waves to them, come over and see. He says, take a look inside. Don't just listen to my words. Look in there. He's gone. He's alive. He says, I rolled away the stone so you can see. Jesus did not need the stone rolled away so he could come out. If you go and continue to read, when Jesus appeared to all his disciples over the next 40 days, he was fully physically resurrected. His body is gone because he's totally physically and spiritually resurrected, new. And when you look at the gospel story just down the road over the next 40 days, Jesus walked through doors. He's God. He walked through walls. He didn't need that stone moved away. He moved it away so we could go in. And the women walk up to the tomb and they look in. And they turn back to the angel and their mouths are just like open. And the angel smiles at him. He says, it's just like Jesus said it would happen. For us today, we've got four gospel accounts. Those gospels tell us all about Jesus, his mission, and he completes it. It's just like he said it would happen, but we got more to that. You open that beautiful Bible, and it goes back hundreds of years, and they're pointing to him coming because it says he'll do exactly what he said would happen. And the last thing that we can learn from an angel sitting on a stone is that death has been defeated. Yeah. This time, I think, there's no words in this part of the scripture. The angel sits on the stone. This time, I think his arms are crossed. Like this. This is angelic trash talk right here, is what this is. If you don't think there's trash talk in the Bible, go to Elijah and see how he pulled out the trash talk. This is angelic trash talk. This is Satan, you brought death. Jesus has beat that death, and now he has life. He's physically and spiritually resurrected. An angel doesn't have to say a word. He looks over at the two fainted dead-like guys, and his expression says, good try. In baseball, you hit a home run, you trash talk by doing a bat flip. This angel did a stone flip, and he's sitting on it. Not only is that stone moved away, he's sitting on it. And that tells us that it can never be rolled back. That tomb was empty that first Easter morning, ladies and gentlemen. That tomb is still empty today, and that's important for us. That stone can never be rolled back. This is for us, too. So there's a very, very important question here in our third sermon note. What side of the stone are we on? Let me paint that picture one more time. We've got an empty tomb right behind me. We've got a stone and an angel sitting on it. We've got two women on the right who are now alive and trembling. They're not trembling with fear now. They're trembling with hope. This changes everything. Jesus took the penalty of the sin to the cross and he died. And now he's completed his mission. And now he's defeated the curse of sin, which is death. Jesus is alive. And he's still got two guys on the left. They're like dead. They're still unresponsive to who Jesus is and what he's done. So which side of the stone are we on today? Are we on the side of being alive and being hopeful? Or are we on the side of the stone where we're still skeptical? I think this is a fairy tale. We're just not sure about it. If you're skeptical, maybe you're on this side. Maybe you are alive today. You're so excited about who Christ is and what he's done. And you can't wait to get out of here and tell somebody about it. And maybe we're here. Like, this is still a new story to me. And maybe I'm skeptical. Can I tell you that's okay? But you're here. So can we walk with you? All you have to do is write on this card. Give us the contact information and say, I'm skeptical. Would somebody walk with me and help me understand this? And drop it in the plate when it comes around. And we'll walk with you. We love you. We want you to know the story. Maybe today you're on this side of the stone and it's time to move to this side of the stone. You're ready. It's time to move, to come alive, to quit being unresponsive to the good news. If that is where you're at today, would you come up right after this service? Or write on this card. Come up and talk to us right at the end of the service, and we're going to rejoice with you. I cannot imagine a better day to wake up to who Christ is and decide to follow him than Easter. Amen? And this pastor with a squeaky voice would love to talk to you as well, if any of our ministry leaders, and rejoice with you. But please do not leave this room today and be unresponsive. I can't think of a better way to celebrate Easter than communion. Ushers, would you come forward with me? Communion here at Westview is open communion. That means if you're a guest with us today and you have a right relationship with Jesus, we ask you, you're part of the body of Christ. We ask you to join in communion with us. We would love to have you join us. We're going to do this a little different today. And that when these come around, I want you to hold the juice and hold the bread. And then in a moment, we're going to go into a song. And I want you to take any time during that song, but before the song is over, okay? Take it when you're ready. I want you to listen to the lyrics, and I want you to listen to the music and worship and reflect on who Jesus is and what he's done. But take the communion by yourself before that song is over. Do we understand that? I'm not going to come back up to take. I want you to do it when the time's right. Now, one thing is that we normally, when we go into communion, we reflect on the scripture verses that talk about Jesus' crucifixion. We talk about this bread being his body given for us as a sacrifice to pay the price for our sin. And we talk about the juice being his blood, which was shed for us. This is a new covenant. There'll never be another covenant. This is God's last agreement with his people. Jesus did it all. But sometimes we don't, what we should talk about in communion is the resurrection, right? Sometimes we get too focused on the cross. But the resurrection is the most beautiful part about communion. So I want to share this scripture verse with you from Romans 6. We did this on Good Friday. It says, could it be any clearer? Our old way of life was nailed to the cross with Christ. A decisive end to that sin miserable life. No longer it sins every beck and call. What we believe is this, that if we get included in Christ's sin conquering death, we also get included in his life saving resurrection. So bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, thank you for your Son. Thank you that you loved us so much you sent him to save us. And that's what we're celebrating today. We're not celebrating the cross. We're celebrating that he's risen. Both are so important. So Father, as we go into the song, I want everybody to take this when the time is right with them to remember this. To have great joy, not guilt, great joy in the way that you've loved us through Jesus. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Displayed for us, oh God.
We have one more note to look at together. The most important note of today. Jesus' resurrection can be my resurrection. This whole Easter sermon series has been titled, It Should Have Been Me. Now let me recap to make sure we understand the depth of God's love through Jesus. We started with Jesus' garden of betrayal. It should have been my garden. But because of him, now I have a garden of paradise waiting for me in heaven. Jesus' trial, it should have been my trial. But now I can stand before Jesus, the judge, as pardoned. Jesus' crown of thorns was my crown of thorns. And now he waits to crown me in heaven. Jesus' cross should have been my cross. And now I get to carry his cross in honor. Jesus' tomb last Friday, Jesus' tomb was my tomb. But now I can leave my sin, my guilt, and my shame in that tomb. And last, and most important, Jesus' resurrection can be my resurrection. You can whoop harder on that. Whoop harder. Give me an amen on that. Jesus' resurrection. But one word makes a lot of difference. There is a simple difference between the word can and will. I can say Jesus' resurrection can be my resurrection, but it's more important that we all walk out of here today to say Jesus' resurrection will be my resurrection. And there's only a small difference, but it's a huge difference, but it's so simple between that word can and that word will. And that word is faith. Faith takes me from can, where I think I can do it on my own. Faith says it's already been done, and his resurrection will be my resurrection. Amen. And this is so beautifully summarized in John 11. It says, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Is what Jesus asked. Amen. Do we believe this? And with faith, can be becomes will be. Jesus' resurrection, everybody, when you walk out of this room today, you need to know this. It can't, don't go with can be. It will be. He's already paid that price. And that's why we're celebrating today. His resurrection will one day be our resurrection. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Ushers, would you come forward, please, for the offering? Let's bow our heads and let's continue in worship here for just a moment, because we need to give back. This Easter day, when we see everything that God's given us, we're going to talk about giving back. So, Heavenly Father, we pray to you that the first offering that we want to give you today is our lives. Father, if we're on the wrong side of the stone, that today we are not afraid and we cross to the other side of that stone and we can have this eternal life, our resurrection will move from can be to will be. Father, if there's somebody in the room that needs that decision today to make, to not be afraid to make that decision today, please don't let them walk out of this room without coming forward here at the end of the service and talking to us or writing on a card. Father, our offering outside of this is everything we got. You've given us everything so we can have hope when we walk out of here today. And Father, all we want to do is give back as lovingly as we can to you in our time, our talent, our gifts, our finances, to move the mission of this church so everybody knows the name of Jesus. We pray this all in his holy name. Amen.
Cause you've risen, I can rise.
you all for being here today. What a great way to start off Easter morning, right? Worshiping together. We're so glad you're here. To our guests, just a couple announcements to our guests. Yeah, drop off this Connect card at our Welcome Center. We would love to connect with you. We're so glad you worshiped with us today. We have this space over here because you all look so nice, dressed up in your Sunday best for Easter. If you want to get a selfie shot or a picture over here, that's for you to take pictures with your whole family. People will be over there to help you do that also. And let me finish with this. The angel on that stone told the Marys one more thing, and it's recorded in Matthew 28:7. He says, "Marys, go quickly and tell everybody what you just saw." And so that's our command today. The angels tell us the same thing. Guys, go and tell. Tell somebody and say, hey, come here. Look inside the tomb. He's risen. Go and tell that to somebody today. Have a great Easter. We'll see you next week.
Yesterday.